to President, you have the floor to open the ceremony, and maybe you could also give us your view on the future of Europe.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you.
Merci, mesdames. Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. President of the European Parliament, Madam President of the European Commission, Prime Minister, ladies and gentlemen, ministers, Madam Vice President of the European Commission, ladies and gentlemen, MEPs, ladies and gentlemen, both in the room today and from afar through remote conferencing. I am quite a happy man to see you, that we can gather once again together today during this Europe Day. I'm very pleased that we're celebrating with a shared political commitment orchestrated by what will become our universal language. The artists are willing to play their part. And here we are gathered in Strasbourg on the 9th of May, which tells us a great deal about who we are, how we're going to work to shape ourselves after the 70 years of a common experience. And looking at the founding moments in our archives. Strasbourg is the city of reconciliation, after all. It is the living symbol of this Europe that said no to war, to build peace, to replace occupation with cooperation, to lift the worries of looking towards the borders, to breathe new confidence and friendship into European souls. That's what Strasbourg is all about. Strasbourg, the capital of Europe, is a symbol. And we're not building an imaginary Europe, but we're building this feeling of belonging. Strasbourg is the home to what it is in its democratic efforts of outreach, and not just looking to the past, but inspired by it to build the future. This is where the European heart beats. The Council of Europe, the European Parliament, the Parliament that unites us, not a weakness, but certainly it allows us to show our strength and to affirm our identity. So, President David, thank you for being here today with this firm decision to start with the European Parliament's work once again in Strasbourg as soon as possible. We discussed this at great length before. This is a founding chronic of time that we just witnessed together, and this should lead us, it should inspire us to basically grow accustomed to the current situation, but to overcome the weaknesses, but to remain permanently optimistic and driven. That is our duty, and we need to breathe a new democratic life into our institutions and to build that confidence that we have in Europe amongst our citizens. We are here in an unprecedented pandemic that has affected us for more than a year worldwide, but most particularly in Europe. When these huge crises fall upon us, and we've had many, many such occurrences in the past, there are always very deep-seated doubts and national instincts that start to make themselves comfortable. We've seen today that some people are challenging what we are about, who we are, and just forgetting everything that we've built up. That's what's at stake today. That's the risk, that is to just give up out of a sense of just not knowing what to do rather than to build on what we've done. And we can already hear people attack Europe, accuse it through this spirit of defeatism. Look at this Europe. Europe missed the boat. And I say it's quite the opposite. In this crisis, it is a European model that really came into its own. And I think we've seen the pathways forward, given the challenges before us. This model is our DNA, our deep identity. I want, basically, in inaugurating this conference, although we've talked about the decades ahead, I wanted to recall that if together we manage to resist in the face of this, it's because for 70 years now we have built together, which didn't just happen, it wouldn't have just have happened by itself, without real effort, through our model of social protection, a Europe characterized by solidarity. It is the result of a model that is productive and social a Europe of competitiveness, of competition, of economic strength, but it is always thought in terms of solidarity from the word go. Solidarity towards the regions, towards local communities, and in terms of ambitious policies. Nowhere else in the world do we have so much importance attached to life, and we're happy with that. And on a continent, when lives are sacrificed in order to preserve the economy, sometimes that wasn't possible. We made that choice in Europe to show our solidarity, a humanitarian face. And we accompanied everybody along the way with our healthcare system, which we funded together. We helped our businessmen, our independent workers, industrialists, and all sectors, the most hardly hit. And we have every reason to be proud of what we've done. Would it just have happened? The poor countries, of course, very strongly hit. Even the other continents trying to act were forced to sacrifice lives, quite simply, to keep the economy going. Otherwise, the crisis would have made more victims. Other countries have sacrificed many of their economic models. They don't have the same solidarity model. I think of our friends, our allies in America. Our model is our strength, and we've managed to resist together. We've managed to come up with a rapid response together, given the crisis that started 10 years ago, an immediate reaction, a rapid budgetary response over the European response of July last year. And together, we built a vaccination campaign. We put it together. We made it happen. And I would like to thank the President of the Commission. We did not have that community competence at the beginning of this crisis. We got our act together, we managed to decide to gain pace, to gain momentum, and yes, European cooperation did save lives and will continue to do so. That's our strength. And yes, this model of solidarity is the one that from the very beginning of the crisis has allowed us to rekindle our faith in solidarity through the initiatives with our African partners, with vaccine solidarity, with our Balkan neighbors, and continuing to build on that solidarity. We're happy, I'm pleased that with our American allies, they're joining us now on this path to help us in our endeavors, to open up, to export doses, the transfer of technology, to produce more vaccines, and particularly to send to all who need it. This cooperation, this spirit of solidarity is bigger than any of us. It is what leads us with our neighbors, and particularly our African neighbors, to build the decades ahead of us. Our second major strength, once again, became clear during this crisis, and I don't think you can possibly say it enough. It's democracy, which is part of our identity. And despite it all, insidiously, more and more, it is being called into question. People are wondering how effective it is. I hear, like you do, the voices of those who are in authoritarian regimes. They haven't been very effective in this crisis. They haven't managed too well. Basically, it's what our citizens expect of us. And of course, if we forget the real consequences of the authoritarian regimes, the lack of freedom, more and more political detainment, university professors are being stifled, it's not just academic. They've forgotten that they are part of history, those that chose to embark on that path. But we have every reason to be happy to carry on, to openly discuss and to conduct in our democracy everywhere in Europe this democratic debate, the criticism, challenging the fights.
Okay, that is Emmanuel Macron addressing a conference on the future of Europe at the European Parliament.